Hello everyone, and welcome to my session. Is there a way that we can build our Azure Data Factory all with parameters based on metadata? My name is Erwin de Kreuk and I'm a lead and data in AI for InSpark, a Microsoft partner in the Netherlands. As InSpark, we help organizations accelerating their digital transformation with impactful Microsoft solutions and expertise. Today, our event couldn't be running without all the proud sponsors we have. Scriptwinner, Global, Proximo 3, Redspire, Agilysys, Hitachi Solutions. Please do visit them and give them a big shout out as a result of our event. Today, I'm going to talk about Azure Data Factory. Azure Data Factory is a hybrid data integration services within Azure. During the session today, I will explain how you can use parameters within your Azure Data Factory, how you can replace these parameters with metadata, how we can log these dynamic pipelines, and a quick walkthrough of a complete solution with Databricks and Azure SQL Database as an endpoint. What I already said, Azure Data Factory is a hybrid data integration service where you can easily extract data from on-premise, cloud sources, SaaS applications, with more than 120 different data connectors. With visual tools, you can build, debug, deploy, and monitor your data pipelines or big data pipelines. And it provides you an easy way to transform data at scale without any coding required for the ELT platform, so the extract, load, and transform platform. And with parameters, you can build a complete dynamic solution, and that's what I'm going to show you today. Within Azure Data Factory, there are a couple of options to use parameters. We have the global parameters, the pipeline parameters, the dataset, the notebook, the linked servers, and the data flow. Passing parameters to Azure Data Factory or Azure Synapse is quite important as it provides the flexibility to create dynamic pipelines. To reference a parameter, you must provide a fully qualified name of the parameter, so no shortens. It's worth noting that the parameter names are case sensitive, so no capitals and lowercase mixed together. And a parameter could be used as a user input, which means that the parameter is passed from the pipeline layer or could be an input coming from an activity within the pipeline. So I can pass it from pipeline A to pipeline B to pipeline C, for example. The global parameters can be used across all your pipelines and it can be deployed in a CI/CD environment. With the global parameters, you can add them as a global one. And the global parameters are only available in Azure Data Factory and not in Azure Synapse Analytics. You can find the global parameters in your management activity hub within your Azure Data Factory, and you must define for each global parameter, you must define the data type. Once you have created that global parameter with the name and the value for it, the pipeline of the parameter will be available as pipeline.globalparameters.theparameterName, as you can see on the screen. With the global parameters, what I already said, you can use them in your continuous integration and deployment solution. There are two options to deploy them. One is through the PowerShell script, which you can see on the screen. You just have to use the JSON file, or you can include the global parameters in your ARM template. So if you enable the option in the top of the screen, you will see that the global parameters will be available in your ARM template parameters for factory.json. I will show you later in the demo how you can deploy these parameters to your next environment. Do you want to know more about how you can use global parameters? Please click on the link in my slides, which will be available after this presentation. The next one is the dataset parameters. For example, you can create one dataset for all your linked service activities. So I have one database with 20 different tables. Normally, a lot of people are creating a dataset for every table, but I want to reuse every time I'm calling the same table, or if I'm storing the same type of tables to my data lake, I want to use the same connection. So what I will do for in this case, I will store my data in a data lake. I'm going to create two parameters, one for the file path and one for the file name, and then I will deploy them to the file system raw. So the directory is the same as the file path, and the file will be the same as the file name. So if I used and the dynamic content, you will see that I can change that to the two parameters, the file path and the file name, into the two boxes there. The next one is the pipeline parameter. If we have just created the dataset parameters with the file path and the file name, and I want to have them from the file path to pass through to my dataset. So in the pipeline, I'm creating the same two parameters, and then I will go to my pipeline, my copy data pipeline. If I go to my sync, you will see that the two parameters just created, there are also available as a value. And I've created this file path parameter on the pipeline level, and I can add them to the these boxes, but also that I will explain in an upcoming demo. The same is for the notebooks. Notebooks is a little bit different. If I use an Azure Databricks notebook, I can use the widgets.txt functionality to fill in a parameter which is coming from my pipeline. So for example, the data lake connection, if I go to my Azure Data Factory pipeline and I'm adding the notebook component, I can see this parameter is coming up. So if I pass the data lake connection for my environment settings, it will be filled in the notebook. Very easy to make your notebook dynamically set up. The last one is the linked services. That's an easy one to use as well. For example, I have one logical server or one SQL server with 15 different databases. I'm not going to create 15 different linked services, but I'm going to create one linked service, and I'm going to make the option database as a variable or as a parameter. So as you can see on the screen, I'm adding database as an option, and now I can fill in every database which I want to connect to as a parameter. And yeah, that's very easy to see. And I will show you in the demo how that will work. So what I have explained to you, that we have on different levels, we have different parameters. So we have them in the link services, the data sets, the notebooks, the pipeline, and the global. And the globals can only be used in Data Factory. The global parameters can only be used in the pipeline. And then you can use the pipeline parameters to pass through to the notebook, data set, and the linked servers. I think it is time to do some demo. Please follow me on the next screen. So I will switch my screen. 2 seconds. So I have opened my Azure portal over here. And the first thing we are going to do is how can we create these global parameters. So if I go to the management pane or the management activity hub within my data factory, which you can find on the left side, I can go to global parameters. What I can do here, I can add a new parameter or I can change. You will see that I have to define the different data types and I have to fill in a value over here. Once I've clicked on save, it will be available later on in my pipeline. So if I go to my pipeline, for example, you will see pipeline parameters. I can use them as well within the how do you call it, the dynamic content. So if I create a new pipeline, for example, where are you? Execute pipeline. Then you will see that it will be available. I think there's something wrong, but I will fix it in a second. Let me check. So going back to my pipeline. As you can see, what I can do now over here, I can create a query, for example, and I can call these global parameters, as you can see over here. But that's not the goal of our demo today. The next thing that I already explained, that you can use these global parameters within your DevOps environment. So I'm going to my demo environment and you will see that I have a file over here where you are the files are added. So if I click here on publish, and you will see that the files are in here. And the second thing is, if you enable the option that the parameters needs to be added to the ARM templates, you will see that they are available over here. And if you want to change these parameters during your release process, then within your release, I'm just using a visual one. I'm going to edit the job task. And if I click on the override template parameters, you will see that these parameters are available over here, as you can see. And I can now change the name, the subscription, or the resource group name, or the raw folder, whatever kind of things you want to change, you can change it over here. Going back to the demo. So I think the first thing we need to show you to you is how we can make our linked services dynamically set up. So I'm going to the source. And as you can see, I have the database name over here. What I want to do, I want to make that dynamically set up. So I'm creating a new parameter called database. I leave the default value in here, but it's not necessary. If I want to use that parameter, I have to go back to my database. I have to click on Add Dynamic Content and select that database. The second step is to test. So I have to fill in a database which is available. So if I click on the Wild World Importers, because that is the database we are going to use today, you click on OK, test connection is successful. So now we have created our linked service dynamically, so I can add whatever which database I want to. So the next step is that we need to create some parameters on our datasets. So I've prepared two datasets. One for my sync and one for my source. So I want to extract data for my source. As you can see, that option of the database is already available over here. But I want to make these options, the table schema and the table name, I want them also be dynamically set up. So I'm going to parameters, going to click on new. Of course, I want to have a source database. I want to have a source table, and I want to have a source schema. Then I can go back to the connection, click on here that I want to have that source database filled in. So the next time I have to fill in the source database, and I want to have the source schema, and I want to have the source table. So I can pass through from another, from the pipeline, I can pass through these three values. I need to do the same thing I need to do for the data lake path. So I'm going to the parameters, going to create the file path, which you already have seen in the presentation, and I'm going to create the file name. And both of them, I will assign to the first one, the file path to the directory. So that's the location in my data lake. And the second one will be, of course, the file name. I'm going to click on save. And then I will go back to my pipeline. And just to show you what happened over here. So if I click on my source, so that's already prepared. So what I've done as preparation, I have created these parameters, which I just added to the datasets. I have added them here as well. I have filled in the default value. And now it's time to assign them, so the pipeline parameter is assigned to the dataset parameter. As you can see, the dataset is asking for three values. So also here, I'm going to click the source database, the source table, and the source schema. And for the sync side, so that's the destination side, I have to do the same. I want to know in which location in my data lake I want to store my data, and then how the file name is called. And you can also make a concatenation of different parameters. So click on save, and let's have a check. So the file path is, you have to write down the values to the demo one folder in my data lake. It's called supplier transactions, of course, .parquet. the source table supplier transactions, the source database, and the purchasing. So let's rock. So it's making the it's queued, and now it's in progress, and it will extract data from my data lake to from my source database, so my wild world importers, to my data lake. And as you can see, I've read 6,000 rows, and I've written also 6,000 rows. So that means that my consistency is verified, that everything is correctly. Going back to my data lake, containers, was locked out. Sorry for that, but this is also happening in the real world. So within my data lake, I have the raw folder, I have my demo one, and as you can see, I have the supplier transactions.parquet file, which I just created here. So I'm going to switch back to the presentation, and I will continue. So the next step is that we need to load our pipelines dynamically. And how can we achieve that? But first of all, we want to have we want to know if we can get answers on the following questions. Can we build our Azure Data Factory pipelines dynamically? I think I almost showed you a little bit, but can we extract data from my sources based on metadata? I will show you as well. Can we log the execution of the pipelines? The fourth question is, can we load the active or current or historical records to a data store? And the last question is, can we build history from extracted data based on metadata? Probably, yes, we can. So, but how do we achieve that? To do that, we have to create a source parameter table in a metadata database. So in this case, I'm just calling it the configuration database. In the database, I need to have a couple of options. Of course, the source name. It's the same like we already had in our data set, the source schema, in which folder in the data lake catalog or in the data lake we want to store it. How is our table going to be called as a destination? The schema as well. Is the record active? Because maybe I don't want to extract all the records. Can we load it incremental, which will be useful as well. And if we load it incremental, what is our incremental loading column? And what will be our last load time. So once we have done that, then we need to make something that I can call the table and then execute the pipeline we just created. To do that, we need two pipelines in total. So one where we going to get our source data. So this is the table where we get all the functionality we need. The result set of that table, we put it into the for each loop container, and then we will call a pipeline. So we are passing all these parameters or values to the parameters of that pipeline, and that pipeline will call first, okay, what is the last load date, and we'll set the last date, but we'll do exactly the same thing. It will copy from my wild world importers to my data lake activity. So I need two pipelines, one for the command and one for the execute. The next step is that we want to add some logging as well on this pipelines. I want to know I need to know one when the execution will start. I want to know if the execution failed. And I want to know if the execution was successful. And I want to store that data into one table. And I want to see as well how many extracted records I've done. If there was a failure, What was the failure message? What time did my pipeline start? And what time did my record end? So I have the table, the pipeline.execution log, and I've created a stored procedure which will insert the new record, insert some metadata, and insert the start time, as you can see over here. So I have the log ID, the description, the pipeline name, the pipeline run ID, the data factory name, logical date, etc., etc. Then, if the pipeline ends, it will update the end time. It will change the status from zero, from running, to finalized, status one. It will add or update the records with some row counts, and it will update some pipeline details, as you can see here. The number of parallel copies, which integration runtime I used, was the data consistency verification verified, and there's also some, an option over there, report Linux to catalog, if this pipeline is ready to write data to Azure Purview. And once the pipeline fails, you will I want to have the end time as well, a new status with the status error, in this case 2, and of course the failure message. I know it's a lot to do, but I think the best thing is to show you how this will work, is going to a demo and show you what is happening over here. So I will switch my screens again. So I'm going back to the demo. This was the pipeline we created before, and now we are going to create two new pipelines. So what I explained, the command pipeline and the execute pipeline. In this case, I'm going to use a configuration database. In the configuration database, I have created a configuration table with the source parameters. And as you can see, I have a source name, the schema, some other options, which we are not going to use currently, but in the first step, we need the source schema, the table destination, and kind of processing and the active and incremental columns. To do that, I want to store the data every time in the correct order, so in the correct folder in my data lake. For that, I have created a view. In that view, I'm defining the path for my data lake. So if I execute this view, you will see that, okay, I have just a pipeline, but it is based on the parameter table, the source name, the source schema, the select query, because I have created the select query over here because I want to know what is my date for the incremental loading. As you can see over here, what is the last load date to extract from the table so that I know the next time from which date I need to load again. The file path in my data lake, so it will be stored in worldwide importers purchasing underscore purchase online and the date. And what is the file name called? So again, and then the year, the month, and some time records. Going back to my data factory, then you will see that I have the comment option over here. You will see the get files, and the get files is looking to that table I just showed you. So all these tables are going to be executed and going to be put in to the for each loop container. In the for each loop container, we will call the execute pipeline. And in the execute pipeline, I have a couple of parameters defined. So again, the file path and the file name. I have replaced the source query or the source schema and the source table for one query, because that's in there. I want to know the select last out, what I just explained to you. The source database is still there. And I want to know the pipeline parameter ID, so I know to which table it belongs. So in the command, the for each, I'm calling call that pipeline. And if I select that pipeline, you will see that I've directly, it knows which parameters needs to be filled in. To add a value formal for each loot container, it will always start with item, dot, and then etc. etc. As you can see, the source database I'm not getting from my metadata, but it's already pre-filled in, what you can see here as well. So once we have done that, I can go to the command, I can click on debug, or I can click on the add trigger. What will happen if I click on debug? I know that I have to execute four files. It will do file by file. So if I click on add trigger, it will do it in parallel. So just for this demo today, I will do the debug. And you will see that all the activities inside of for each loop will be executed sequentially and not parallel. But it doesn't matter. So it's creating a copy file. If I want to see what is happening, I can click on the pipeline run ID and it will be transferred to the correct pipeline. It's getting my last load date. And as you can see, it said, okay, the last load date is this date from yesterday. It will start doing the copy. And then at the end, it will update, it will update my configuration source parameter table with the correct date. So if you can see it over here, the last load date was 2001. And now if I do execute it again, you will see it has changed. This is the last load, not from the SIF from today, but from the last load date, which I can find in my source table. So if there's a run executing tonight, I will have a new date tomorrow over there. So going back to my comment, and hopefully it did some more. So it's almost there. And as you can see, almost the last table is there as well, and it will execute it in sequential, and the last table is over here. So the next step is that we need to implement some logging. How can we do that? First of all, we need to add a new table, and this time it's called the pipeline.executionLog table, where I log the log ID, the description, and some metadata, but also the number of rows, the failures, and some metadata about the pipeline. And then I have created three stored procedures. What I already explained, the begin, the end, and the error. My begin message, or my procedure, will insert a new record in that pipeline execution.log with all the metadata and of course, the start time. The end will add or update the record with all the number of rows. They are optional, but you can update them. And of course, if I have an error, I want to know that there is an error with the status 2 and what the failure message will be. So going back to the pipeline, I've prepared something. So the first one, we did only the copy. The second one, we did used for each loop container. And now in the third one, we will add the logging. What is happening over here? So first of all, we will call the stored procedure, the audit on begin. As you can see, I'm calling the database link service, the stored procedure. And if I create a stored procedure, it will die directly if I I have to add all the different metadata options. So I have the factory, that's a default one from the system variables. The trigger type as well, is it scheduled, is it manually? The parent log ID, did I get a previous pipeline, and to which pipeline does it belong? I will show you in a bit how that worked. The name and the run ID, so I can trace it back to which run it was, and to match it to the Azure monitoring system. Then I want to know the number it's created, so the log ID which is was created in the pipeline, so I can use it later on. Then just getting the files for each loop container. If there's a failure here, I'm calling the stop procedure on error. As you can see, every time I want to know if there's an error, I have to create a new activity. So like previously, what you had in SQL Server Integration Services, you can do an OR, but this is always an AND. So if I enable this one to here, both has to be filled, and that's what you don't want. And for the command actually pipeline, I have the audit on AND, and you will see that I update the AND record. And in the pipeline, the end date is defined, and of course here. So what is happening here? I have created that command pipeline, and now I will pass through the log ID from the command to my execute pipeline, so the parent log ID. So that's in the next time, I know, okay, this command did execute all these different pipelines. So the execute, also the same logging, the load date, and the same functionalities we did before, the source data with the file path, and we can execute it. So if I execute this one, I will do it with a trigger now. So everything will be executed in parallel. Going back to my logging table. So execution.log. Sometimes it's just timing out, I don't know why, but in the meantime, the process is running, so we are not losing any time. So going to the execution log, and now you will see that the command has executed, so that it was log ID number one, and the parents is, they all belong to that number one, and it has also created the execute. So the execute pipeline name from the engine, what I just did, some metadata, the logical date, the operator, the start time, it's not ended yet. And the very important thing is, if you go back now to the logging over here, we can also log it into the, it's still running a bit. You will see that this is calling all the pipelines. But it is also to show you what will happen in the audit on end. Audit on end, you will see that there are some options over here. So if you look to the source output, you will see that I have rows read, rows copied, the duration, etc., etc. These records can be used within the pipeline. So going back to that execute pipeline, audit on end, you will see, as you can see over here, I'm using from the activity copy source ELS, the billing reference activity type, or I am chasing the rows read. So if you want to use dynamic content from your output from one of the activities, you have to define the activity name and then the output and then the value you want to read. In the meantime, I think the session is finished. Going back to our logging system, and now we will see that we probably have an end time. Yes, we have an end time. The status, we have the number of rows which has been read, as you can see over here. There are 42 new rows as well. We have no failure messages, and we have some extra data over here. So now we have created a couple of things. So going back to the presentation, the demo we did. So I think the first step we did, build something dynamically, extract data from the sources based on metadata we did, the log execution of the pipelines, And we still have two options. Can we load the active or the historic rights to a data store? And can we build the history from extracted database based on metadata? I think we can. What I did is we created a high-level overview where most of the things I already showed you. So I did the extract part, so loading the data to the raws on. Then using Databricks, that's what I will show you, to the intermediate zone, and then use Data Factory to load everything to SQL. I will first check before I continue if my Databricks is running, because otherwise it takes too long. It's not running. I'm just going to start it, and then in the meantime, I will explain it in my session. So what we need to do, the first step I already showed you just in all the demos. So we have created the data lake command, and then we have the for each loop container with the execute, and we have some logging on it. The second step is that we want to load the data into a Delta Lake. So we want to pick up the raw parquet folder and load that to a Delta Lake to build our historical layer for the future use. Also here, I'm using the same concept, so the Delta Lake command, and then it will execute every time all the different files. I need to have some logging there as well. The last step is to load the data from the Delta Lake to a data store. And then we have some logging as well. And that's we all want to run in one flow, so the daily run. So we're now ready to do another demo. So let's switch the screens again. And I will show you the complete solution from A to B, C, etc., etc. So going back to our data factory, what I first will do if I check if my cluster is running, because that will be necessary to run the process, and otherwise we are waiting. And then I go to order, and then I will show you the whole solution over here. First of all, what I will do, I just showed you in the other screen, that I have created one pipeline where I define my daily process. So the data lake, the Delta Lake, and the Delta Lake to the SQL. I'm just going to start it so it will run in the background. And in the meantime, I can explain the other parts. So I have three different folders, the data lake, the Delta Lake, and the data store. And if you can see, the command is the same I just showed you in the other demos. The only thing what I did with the execution is that I want to know the kind of file type for the data lake file. And I want to insert the file when it is processed in my data lake, to my data lake. I want to put a file into a new table that I know, okay, this file was new in my data lake, and I have to process that for my Delta Lake. Because if you do incremental loading, you have to do first the oldest and then up to the newest one. And maybe you don't want to load your Delta Lake every couple of hours. And maybe you want to extract your data from your source system every hour. The second step is that we need to load the data to the Delta Lake. Also here, the command file is looking the same. The only thing over here is that we have the a different activity, the Delta Lake activity. And as you can see over here, I'm passing through all different parameters filled in by the pipeline parameters. And these parameters are available within the notebook. So if I go to the notebook within my Databricks, so Delta Lake over here, then you will see that these Data Lake connection source file is incremental. The widgets.txt file will be available. And when the process is running, I can show you what the system is doing. And the last one is the data store. Also, you see the command pipelines are all the same, only with a different name, and then they are calling a different file. Also here, it's creating a copy file from the Delta Lake, from the intermediate layer to my data store. So going back to the system to see how much files there are processed. So it is still busy with copying the files from from my SQL. It's done, and now it is in the process of executing the files to the Delta Lake. So if I look to the file, I've created a new file over here or table. I can see that it is running these files. So these are the new files just added in the system. They are loaded, they are not processed yet. So if I open one of these notebook files, which you can see over here, so here it is running, I will just see what the process is doing. So as you can see, I've this cell has been running, and this is the result set. So I have my data lake connection, I have the source file, I have the incremental loading options. Then I will load the data into a new frame. I will add some fields to that data frame for auditing. Then I will write the sources back as a Delta file. And I do some more things to see. And at the end of the file, I'm not going to explain the whole Delta Lake concept, but at the end of the file, this is quite important, is that you can see over here that at the end, I do an exit, a notebook exit, and then I gave all the result sets back within the JSON.dump, which I can reuse as an output parameter of my activity, and then can be used as an input for my stored procedure to fill in these rows extracted, rows new, rows unchanged, what I showed you before. So going back to here, we do a refresh, and then you will see that here on the Delta Lake, I have these outputs, and that I will use these outputs here as an input, as you can see, rows read, rows new. Just to show it in the execution here on end, and you will see that I am reading the output.run output.rows new as an input parameter of my stored procedure. At the end of the file, you will see that I have loaded all the records completely. If I then look into the logging, you will see my process has started over here, the control run daily. I first did the comment, so that belongs to there. So you will see the parent lock ID here as well, what is belonging to what. Then I did the ADLS or data lake to the Delta Lake, and then the Delta Lake to the SQL, including all the metadata, the records executed and new, and some more stuff over here. And for a notebook data, for a database notebook, I'm adding directly the job. So I can copy this one, I can go directly to my Internet Explorer, to my Edge, and I can see the complete results from the executed notebook, as you can see over here. Pretty cool to see that all running. And then based on these kind of data tables, you can create some great Power BI reports to see the whole execution and how long the execution was taking along. So going back to the presentation, to finalize everything. Yeah, cool. So the last questions I want to ask to you is, can we load the active current or historical records to the data store? Okay, I didn't show you that. Going back to here, I have a file over here. Let me show you. Yeah, top 100. And now you can see that I have a current record, the hash key to see if the record has changed or not. The current record, the record start date, the modified date, and the end date. And I can define this historical part within the source parameter by the process type. So this means that I only want to have the active record, so only with the status current. And if I define the process type, I want to see also the historical data of that file. So the historical part of the Delta Lake. So yes, we did. Yes, we did. And yeah, this is the end of my session. So if there are some questions left, please do not hesitate to ask them in the chat. Otherwise, send me the question on Twitter, Erwin de Kreuk, or on LinkedIn. And otherwise, you can always send me an email through my website, to my blog, erwindekreuk.com. And my slides will be available on the event website, but also later on SlideShare and on my blog. So I want to wish you a pleasant evening. And thanks for joining, and hopefully see you next time. Thank you. Bye-bye.